singers, and also the word of God which he heard from the overseer about our families and also about the nations. Amen. And I want to reiterate that God is a God of families.
Amen.
Like he earlier on mentioned that it is up to us as Christians, as people of God, those who have known God, to believe God for the salvation of our families. According to the book of Acts, where he read, he said, the Bible says, believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be saved, you and your house,
or
meaning your family.
Amen.
And it is important, and it is that which God wants us to desire, that we may be together. You know, when I was thinking about the families and what God has been doing to us, and it actually excites me that we are called the family of God Church.
Amen.
Why? Because we are a family.
Amen.
When you come to the family of God Church, you don't feel like a stranger because we are a family. The greatest family we must be excited about is the family of God.
Amen.
You belonging to the kingdom, which is called the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
And I believe that I'm going to impart something short, and it's going to bless you, because our God is a God of blessings.
Amen.
And
Amen.
This is what I can give you in this family Sunday. When you leave this place, when you come out of this meeting in this London Family of God Church family service, you can say, God blessed me and I met with God. Amen.
Amen.
We are reading from the scriptures, and as we open to the word of God, let's make a good confession. Let's say the word of God is alive. We are reading from Psalms chapter number 23. And as we open to Psalm 23, let's make a good confession. Say, the word of God is alive.
It is active.
And it is working in my life today. The Lord gives wisdom. Out of his mouth proceeds knowledge and understanding. And I receive it today. Amen. I want to appreciate the servants of God here, the bishops, Bishop Makao, the elders. And in simple terms, I said, all protocol observed. Amen. Hallelujah. From Psalms chapter number 23, the Bible says here, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures, and he leadeth me beside still waters. He restored my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yet though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let's just pray. Father God of heaven, we want to thank you. I thank you this day, for this is the day which you have made. I pray, Father, even for these, your people, who are here to listen and to hear from you. I pray, Father, for the entrance of the word of God, that you may open their hearts and their spirits, and that they may partake of the things that are coming from your throne. I even pray that, Lord, that you may anoint my lips, that you may give me revelation, that I may speak the word of God as I want to speak, and the things that must be, which are in your way, that they may come to pass. In their lives, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know, it is important to know that God's desire is that you may partake of the good which he has promised. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Is that he wants you to partake of the good which he has promised. But the danger and the problem we have in the world is that people, they don't know what God has for them. And if you don't know what God has for you, you grow up in darkness trying to get what you don't know that God has already prepared for you. And so today I want you to know that God wants you to be able to get what belongs to you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And how do you get that which belongs to you? It is by knowing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
By knowing God himself. So you must know God and what he is able to do for you. And when you know God and that which is able to do for you, you'll be able to go and take what belongs to you. A person who doesn't know that there are certain things which are ready for him, he will suffer forever. I always give a simple testimony of my father-in-law, who was a personal manager in a good hotel, Mikus Hotel, for 37 years. And he didn't know some of the benefits which the company, which he was entitled to. For 20 years of 37 years, he was working on foot. He was fighting to drive his old Mercedes Benz, which was manufactured in 1970. He didn't know that he was entitled to a company car. And for 20 years, he spent all those years struggling and actually being careful about his car. And it was the time, it was only that time when he realized that, when he was asking his friends, "You guys, why are you enjoying life? I heard that you've gone for holiday. You've gone to Caribbean. You've gone to this place. Where did you get the money?" And then they said to my father-in-law, "Wow, don't you know that you're entitled to 3 holidays per year?" And he said, "For 20 years, I was not enjoying." What are you talking about? He was very angry, and he went and shouted at the managers and all those things. But finally, he got his company car and started to enjoy. And this is exactly what many of the people of God are doing. We spend years in this life because we don't know the things which are, we are entitled to.
Yeah.
We even at times try to follow and ask God and beg God the things he has already given to us.
Hallelujah.
Because the Bible tells us he has given us all things freely. The things that pertain to this life and the things that pertain to godliness.
Hallelujah.
And today I want to challenge you, how many things you are struggling about which God has already given you? God has given you joy. He has given us a lot of things. Now that's why I'm reading from the book of Psalm 23. Yeah. David was a man like us who experienced God was working with God. But the first thing he had gone through a lot of things, a lot of troubles, a lot of problems. But he came to a conclusion in chapter number 23. And he said, "The Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want." You know, when you know what God, the first thing you must know in order for you to get what God has for you is to know him.
Amen.
You must know God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You must know God, the one who is your shepherd. When you say the Lord is my shepherd, is the one who feeds you. A shepherd, he leads people. A shepherd takes care of you. A shepherd provides for you. If God is your shepherd, brothers and sisters, you know that I can have somewhere to go to. I have someone to lead me where I'm supposed to go. A shepherd is not just a person who just stands there, but he goes before you. He wants to make sure that things are all right for the flock. And this is the kind of relationship which us, we must have with our God. As families, we must be able to have a shepherd in our lives.
Amen.
And that shepherd must be the Lord. David was able to say, "The Lord is my shepherd, not other people's shepherd." And today, maybe you were invited to this family Sunday because your relatives come to this church because they said, "I have got a God, I worship God," but let God, that God be your shepherd also. That when you leave this place, you'll be able to say, "The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my God. He is mine." In other words, you must have the Lord as your Lord. You may have God as your God. And this is what God is calling us. Let God be and let Jesus be your Lord.
Amen.
If you are here today, don't leave this place the same again. Maybe you have heard the people, maybe you have sung songs, but you have not taken the Lord as your Lord.
Yes.
You can be able to say, "He is mine." When you grew up, we used to sing a song, "Mine, mine, mine, Jesus is mine."
Amen.
He can be yours. He can be yours. He can walk with you. He can lead you. He can direct you. He can be with you in your family. We want families. We say, "The Lord is our Lord. The Lord God is our God. He's the God of Jacob, Isaac, Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac." And you can be saying about your family that that God is the God of Majonga. He's the God of his children. He's the God of entry. He's the God of Murimbariba. He's the God of Tafara. Because you have taken the Lord as your shepherd.
Hallelujah.
And today, as families, take the Lord as your shepherd.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Take the Lord as your shepherd. The Lord is our salvation.
Hallelujah.
True salvation comes by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you know, when you believe that he is the one who died for you on the cross, believing the work which he did for you on the cross of Calvary, he will become your savior. What am I saying? Have a personal relationship with that God.
Amen.
Don't know God by remote.
Yep.
Don't know God by hearsay. Don't know God by others who are giving testimonies about the goodness of God when you yourself have no personal experience of God. David was able to say, "He is mine," because he had an experience of him.
Hallelujah.
When he was dark, when the things were dark in his life, he was able to say, "Lead me." That's why you read in the Psalms, he said, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I.
Amen.
Why? Because he had a relationship with that Lord. Hallelujah. Till you are able to say, the Lord is your shepherd, you cannot see the benefits. You cannot enjoy the benefits.
Hallelujah.
Because when David said, the Lord is my shepherd, what happened, number one? He said, I cannot want.
Amen.
When the Lord is your shepherd, you will not want. But before I get to the benefits of those who know God as their shepherd, as their Lord, I think you need to set things right. We can't talk of the benefits which you are not entitled to unless you are employed to that employer. I was talking about my father-in-law, that he was employed by Miklos Hotel, and he was able to ask, you guys, how dare I was not benefiting on all these things when you have employed me? But you are not able to do that to God unless you have a relationship with him.
Amen.
Unless you have a relationship with the Lord, with God himself. And the only way you can relate with God is when you give your life to Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
The one who said, behold, I stand at the door of your heart knocking. If any man open his heart, I'll come in and eat with him.
Amen.
And he with me.
Amen.
The Bible tells us, he who has the Son of God has got life. But he who doesn't have the Son of God does not have life. So the first point of call is to make him your Lord and
Amen.
Your Savior.
Amen.
And then after you've made him your Lord and your Savior, then I can talk about the benefits. Then we can pray about the benefits. Then we can claim them. Then we can become what he said we can become. How many of you whilst you are sitting there? Maybe you are here because we're invited, because someone invited you, that let's come and eat him. Partake of the rest of the benefits. Because you are getting into a contract. The contract you must have with God is that of personal relationship.
Amen.
Of salvation, of knowing you as your Lord and Savior. Bow your head, close your eyes in the presence of God.
Amen.
Every person in this place, I want you to take both your hands and put them on your heart. And why we do that? Because salvation must come inside.
Amen.
It is from the heart. That's why God said, my son, give me your heart. And then he said, you see, the Bible tells us by faith and confession that he is Lord, you will be saved. I want you to pray after me and just pray a simple prayer of making your life right with God, taking the Lord as a shepherd and as a savior. Just pray after me. Say,
dear God in heaven,
I come to you today.
I admit that I'm a sinner.
I was on my way to hell
because of my sins.
But I thank you that you gave your son Jesus to die for me on the cross so that my sins may be forgiven.
Lord Jesus,
I invite you, come into my life, forgive my sins, change me inside, make me a child of God. Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, for forgiving me. From today onwards, I'll worship you and I'll serve you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I said, God's desire is that he may be your shepherd. Now he is your shepherd. But there are benefits which follow afterwards.
Amen.
And these benefits now is what he said, because the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I will not want, I will not have any needs, I will not have anything lacking in my life.
Amen.
Because I have taken the Lord as my shepherd.
Amen.
He said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I want you to know that we have entered into a season which God is saying, let it be a thing of the past in your life.
Amen.
The things you then have in your life, because you have made the Lord your shepherd, it will be a thing of the past. Because he said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I will not let anything. In the past, I've left. In the past, I've left the cars. In the past, I've left the houses. In the past, I've left the things. But I've taken the Lord as my shepherd. Let is not going to be mentioned in my life anymore.
Amen.
Because God is in the business of providing for those who know that he is the one who lead them.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He said, I shall not want. In Psalms chapter number 34, the Bible tells us there, in verse number 4, he said, I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears. And then verse 5 said, they looked unto him, and they were enlightened, and their faces were not ashamed. He said, the poor man cried unto the Lord, and he heard him, and sent him out of all his troubles. Today I have come to say, ceasefire.
I've come to say examples are going because the Lord is in the house. The Lord is in this place. If you cry to him, if you tell him, you are my shepherd, he said, I have cried unto the Lord, even the poor.
Amen.
He said, the poor. Poverty is not money only. You can be poverty in the spirit. You can be poverty in resources. You can be poor. You can be poor. Actually, you can be poor in the spirit. You can be poor in resources. You can be poor in knowledge. But God said, when you cry unto the Lord heard him and delivered them out of all their troubles.
Amen.
God is in the business of delivering somebody today.
Hallelujah.
Because there is an anointing. There's an action of delivering people out of lack, out of poverty, out of troubles. I want to dare and prophesy to you, feminists, in this place today. Maybe there were troubles in your life. There were problems. There were challenges, whether financial, whether physical. But God said, I'm come that I may deliver you from all your troubles. Because you have chosen me as your shepherd. Because I am a good shepherd who comes to deliver. When the sheep is in trouble, I'll come and deliver him. When the sheep is in lack, I'll come and deliver him. So he said, I shall not want. He said, he cried unto the Lord. When the poor man cried unto the Lord, and he heard him and sent him out of his troubles. I thank God today that you may be in trouble today, but God has come to deliver you out of all your troubles.
Yeah.
I don't care what how many final demands are in your life. I don't care how many khaki envelopes you have received, but because our God is a God who is faithful, who hears the cry of his people, those who take him as his their Lord and their shepherd, those who come to him and say, Lord, we depend on you. He said, I will deliver you from all your troubles. Troubles are going today. They are going out of your marriages. They are going out of your families. The troubles which were haunting your families, your children, because the Lord said the poor man cried unto the Lord. I don't know what the poor man cried for. Maybe cried for because there was trouble in the house. But the Bible said the Lord delivered them out of all their troubles. All their troubles. There's no trouble which is bigger than God. The Bible tells us, we used to sing a song, bigger than your problems.
Amen.
Bigger than all your problems. Bigger than all your fears. God is bigger than every mountain that you can see and you cannot see.
Amen.
And this family Sunday, I want you to know that it doesn't matter how big your mountain is. It doesn't matter how big your problem is. It doesn't matter what the devil has said to you. It doesn't matter who prophesied doom on you. But I want to say to you, the Lord God is the good God who has come to deliver us from all our troubles. Like in the days of Moses, he said, yeah, Moses, go and call these people and tell them, I'm come down. I've heard the cry of the children of Israel, but I'm come down that I may deliver them from their trouble. And this is the kind of God we worship in the family of God church. This is the kind of God with Apostle Taunash is inviting us to come with him. As we come with the men of God, the apostle, there are good things you are going to come to us. He said, come with me that you may partake of the good things which God has promised him. He has promised his servant, he has promised us. And these good things are the ones I'm talking about. He said, oh, test and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord. Oh, he said, for there's no want. That's verse number 8 of Psalms 34. He said, and there's no want. There's no what? Want. There's no want. There's no want. If you love the Lord, if you test God and see how good he is, he said, there's no want to them that fear him. There's no one to them that worship him. There's no one to them that follow him. There's no one to them that praise him. There's no one to them that are excited about him. That's why David was able to say, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Because in the house of the Lord, when I entered the house of God, I had wants, I had needs, I have problems. But because I fear God, the Bible says, there's no one to them that fear the Lord. He said, the young lion do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing.
Amen.
Oh, yes. He said, you shall not lack any good thing. Any good thing. How many of you want good? I'm sure every one of you want good in this place.
Uh-huh.
But hear what the word of God says. The Bible says here, but they that seek the Lord, they that follow him, that take him as their shepherd, that take him as their God, they will not want any good.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So God wants us to get every good thing.
Amen.
And he wants us also to be in good places.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He wants us to have good things, which has promised us in his word. Amen.
Amen.
And I want you to know that there are certain places where you are ordained to get those good things.
Yeah.
It's not everywhere. Because there are many people who want to go around going this place and getting this oil, getting this water, getting this this kind of thing, thinking that I'll get the good things. It's either you get demons with you. If you are ordained to be that place, you get good things.
Yeah.
If you are ordained to this place, you enjoy the good which the Lord has prepared for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
This is one of the prophetic words which the servant of God, the apostle, was given in these last days. He said it's a season of invitation.
Amen.
And those who are going to come with you, who are going to come with us, they are going to be partakers of the good. Right?
Amen.
Which the Lord has promised in this environment.
Amen.
Let me challenge you. Do not come to the family of God Church because you think it's exciting. But come to the family of God Church because you have been invited and you have seen the good which God has promised to us. Like a person who is born in their family. There are many people who would want to choose where to be born, but you cannot choose where to be born.
Yeah.
Mr. Howard was giving a Mrs. Howard a very powerful testimony here. They wanted to choose a church. But with God, there's no choice of churches. But God Himself will invite you to Himself.
Amen.
And then the choice is there, you say yes or not. That's why even the Bible says in the book of John, John 3 verse 6, it says, for God so loved the world.
Amen.
And he gave his only begotten son, Jesus. For whosoever, in other words, it's a choice to take heed of the call of the invitation. So this is what I mean. Being in the African revival, in the worldwide family of God Church, is God who planted you in here.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And if you are planted here, you must cry to say, Lord, I want to partake of the blessings which are found in this place. I don't want just to be here and not get blessed. I'm tired of living a life where others come out with the testimonies and I don't have one.
Amen.
I want to be an eyewitness of the workings of God, of the duties of God, of the new frontiers, of open doors.
Amen.
Of open gates. Hey, you know, of all these abandoned and others which are coming to us. We must cry for them because I belong to the house of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Like we don't choose a family. God ordained us to be in this place.
Amen.
That great things may happen to you. That good things may happen to you. You must desire good to happen to you. Because the Bible tells us that they that fear the Lord, they will not want anything good. Even good jobs. Even good business. Even good marriages. Good families. Good children. Well-mannered children who fear the Lord. Was touched by my little niece who was confessing that I'm thoroughly, thoroughly saved.
Amen.
From the version, I'm thoroughly saved.
Amen.
In the book of Psalms, he said, he leadeth me beside still waters.
Amen.
He said, he made me lie down.
Amen.
God wants you to sleep good.
Yeah.
Right? He doesn't want you to sleep on the couch. He wants you to enjoy your bed. He wants you to sleep good. He said, he maketh me lie down. Not sleep standing. How many of us today, we have a house, we spend more time at work than the house we are paying a mortgage for, and we are not even sleeping in that bed? He maketh you lie down.
Amen.
He maketh you lie down. 24/7 we are working. But he wants you to sleep good.
Amen.
When you talk about sleeping good, you are not just sleeping. I'm not talking about just getting into bed. A bed which is not well prepared, which is not even made. You just woke up, going to work, and you come and just put yourself inside there. You know, it must be a good bed, well prepared, where you can sleep and you can enjoy. He maketh me lie down. Hallelujah. He made me lie down in green pastures. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So the third thing, he wants you to sleep good. Ask yourself where you are sleeping. Is it a good place? Because God even wants you to sleep in a good place. You say, wherever, I don't care. As long as I close my eyes. When God said, He maketh me lie down.
Amen.
In green pastures. It means in comfort.
Amen.
Desire the best for yourself. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is the anointing. Right? The apostle spoke to us in these last days. That is a releasing. A serious anointing. Which is called in the navigation to win. You can't navigate. You know, when you say navigation to win, you don't have to navigate in your bedroom because you have no way to sleep. It must look good so that you navigate straight to the bed, which is well prepared and good.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Number four. He said, He restored my soul. And this is a season you must know and you must understand that in this season of this winning navigation, God is restoring what the devil has stolen from us.
Amen.
It's a time of restoration. I want to say to you, God is saying, He restored my soul. Even if you are lost, God is going to restore you back. That's why we can hear testimony of people who are saying, I'm thoroughly saved. They have been in the church for a long time, but because he's in the business of restoring what belongs to him, he said, He restores my soul. God is a God of restoration. He wants to restore that which the devil has stolen. He wants to restore your family together. He wants to restore your children. Those who think that they are going to go to hell, God is going to restore them to himself. They are going to come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. He's going to restore the church to its old position.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's a season of turning around. God is going to turn around the things in your life. Where the devil has stolen from you, he's going to restore. When you say restoring, he's paying back, giving you back what the devil has stolen. Some of us, joy has been stolen in our marriages, in our families. We couldn't talk to one another. But you must cry to God and say, restore my soul. Not only my soul, restore our joy, restore our unity, restore our togetherness, restore our oneness. When God comes to restore you, brothers and sisters, you can work together. You can eat together. Two women can share the same kitchen. They will not say we can't share the same kitchen because we have different things we want to cook. Because when God restores love and unity, you can be together again. God can restore you to the servant of God again and see you at the servant of God. This is my spiritual father. I can benefit from him. God can restore that which is stolen from the devil. He is the Lord who wants to restore that which was stolen by the devil. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why Isaiah 60, the Bible says, the sons also of them that are afflicted, they shall come, bending unto thee. In other words, they will come back to you. It's the restoration. I want to say to the family of God church, there's going to be restoration. Even though the people who were mocking you, they are going to come and worship God in this place. They say, teach us the God you serve, who is able to deliver, who is going to be able to heal, who is able to do mighty miracles. I want to say that the people who were despised because you were Christian, God is going to work and work in your life. God, your families are going to come to you and say, take us to the God who we worship. And then let's go to the house of the Lord. He said, let us go to the house of God, and that may learn his ways, your ways, because God is a God of restoration. I want to say those with people, relatives who were gone astray, maybe because of the world, they are going to be restored to you.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
You'll be sure that they will come. When they come, don't chase them away.
Yeah.
You listen to me.
Yeah.
Restoration does not mean that the things which were restored, they come clean.
Yeah.
They come dirty so that you may clean them up.
Amen. Yeah.
Yeah? To the charismatic and Pentecostal spiritual people who always want to be holy, holier than thou, and you never sinned in your life. When you see someone sinning, you want him to be like you, but you have been a Christian for 20 years, and the child who comes to church today wants him to be like you.
in 2 minutes. When God restores people to you, receive them.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
God has not only restored you the things he wants to restore from you. But the question, are you seeing that it is God who is restoring them to you?
Hallelujah.
Even money, even position, even business, even families, even children, even relatives. It's possible that you can cooperate with the devil to destroy what God is trying to restore.
But the Bible says he restored my soul.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Isaiah 16, verse 14 and 15. The sons also of them that afflicted thee shall come bending unto thee.
Yeah.
And they that despise thee shall bow themselves down to thy soul, to the soul of thy feet. They shall call thee the city of the Lord, the Zion of the Holy One of Israel. Whereas thou hast been forsaken and hated, so that no man went through thee, I will make thee an eternal excellence, the joy of many generations. Violence shall no more be heard in thy land, or wasting nor destruction in thy borders, but thou shalt call thy world salvation, and thy gates praise. The sun shall no more go down, neither shall thy moon withdraw itself, for the Lord shall be thy everlasting light, and the days of thy mourning shall be ended. Restoration means the days of your mourning.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Let me say again. The days of your mourning are ending.
Amen.
The days of trouble are ending.
Amen.
The days of sorrow are ending.
Amen.
To some nations, they are crying. The days of oppression are ending. But it doesn't matter whatever. You may call mourning or whatever. You may call problem. But it is ending because God has spoken.
Hallelujah.
He said the days of your mourning are ended. The days of desolation are ended. God is in the business of repaying or restoring to us that which was stolen by the devil. And this is what I've come to say to you, families. God is restoring that which was stolen from you by the devil. Maybe the devil has stolen joy in your family. Maybe the devil has stolen joy in your marriage. Maybe the devil has stolen joy in your church. Maybe the devil has stolen you, stolen from you people. Maybe the devil has stolen from you money. Maybe the devil has stolen from you building. But we are in a season of restoration. God is working in restoring what belongs to us. Like in the book of Job, Job chapter number 42, verse 10, the Bible tells us, and the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends, and also the Lord gave him twice as much as he had before. That's what that's restoration is all about. When God restores, he doesn't give you the same measure. He doubled it. He will multiply it. He will triple it. He will give you 100-fold. And I'm glad to say, citywide family of God, Church London, God is going to triple you. I want to say every African Bible congregation, God is restoring to us. He's giving us double what the devil has done to us. He'll give us 10 times and 100 times. Because the Bible tells us, then it came to pass unto him when all his brothers and all his sisters, they had been of his appointed before and did eat bread with him in the house. And they boomed him and comforted him over all the evil the Lord had brought upon him. Every man also gave a piece of money. That was restoration.
Amen.
This was a poor man.
Yeah.
Everything of Job was taken.
Amen.
He had nothing, but he said, I want to eat. We thank God the overseer is making us eat today.
Amen.
But I hope he brought pieces of silver also to live. Yeah. Because, you know, they did not only come to eat. That's what the Bible says there. His acquaintances, his families, those relatives, they also came up. And then they did eat bread with him in the house. And they mourned him and comforted him of all the evil. And then in verse 12 he said, so the Lord blessed the latter end of Job
more
than his relationships in the family.
Amen.
In the church. You can't talk to one another. You can't smell to one another. You have got a false love and false acceptance of one another. You are children of God.
Yeah.
Not obedient to the word of God. Disobedience to the command of God. He says, love one another. You don't care. Hallelujah. But the Bible says the sin of disobedience is worse than witchcraft. It's like the sin of witchcraft.
Yeah.
And I ask myself, so do we have witches in church?
And you realize, yes, it's possible that we can have witches. Yeah. Those who don't obey the word of God, they are turned into witches.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But God is throwing things to us. When I concluded this place, the overseer is going to pray for families. And one of the things he was going to pray for families is to heal broken relations. Not only marriages, but relationships with, between brothers and sisters, mothers, grandchildren, where we don't see eye to eye. Some of us children, we don't even think about our old mamas, wherever they are, whether in Jamaica, whether they are in Asia, whether they are in Africa. We don't care about them. We don't even dare think about them. And we are disobeying the law of God, which says, honor your father and mother. So that there is on earth may be blessed, may be many, may be blessed by God. But such things can hinder you to partake of the good which God has promised you. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
And also God will lead us in the path of righteousness. Whilst we are Christians, it doesn't mean that temptations, they don't come. But you must be able to overcome temptation with righteousness. That's why he was able to say, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. Thou art with me, and thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Even the devil tries to kill you, God is with you. If the devil tries to give you sickness, I was hearing about blessing that he wants us to see death. Even if the devil wants to see, you know, when you are in sickness, the devil wants you to see your grave in your coffin. But you must get up and say, even if I see a coffin, even if you make me to dream a coffin, I will not fear all evil. Because God is with me, I'm going to live. My Lord is with me. He is my healer. I shall not die, but I will live and declare the works of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.